ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहि तेजस्विनावतीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहि ॐ शांति शांति शांति
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Sibal, Mr. Daruwalla, Mrs. Sibal, all family members of Mr. Sibal, in good stand today. It's a pleasure to see you all. And ladies and gentlemen, it gives me indeed a great pleasure to extend a very warm welcome to you all to the launch of the book Snowflakes of Time, Memories and Musings by Mr. Sibal. Now we've been India is one of the finest diplomats. Now it is indeed a pleasant surprise to see a hardcore diplomat like Mr. Sibal to preserve and nurture a reflective and introspective facet of his persona. I didn't know it frankly till now. Look, we have served for a long time together when I was in uniform and you were the foreign secretary, and later on now in the VIF. So it is indeed a very pleasant job today to be making opening remarks for a book, though I would also say in the same breath that I am sanguine that I am hardly qualified to be speaking on poetry. Firstly, my profession, I am a soldier. Secondly, as General Sani keeps saying here that I am an infantier. These are the people of the mud and slush and all. So nowhere close to poetry at this kind of thing, but still, it's indeed a pleasure for me. So, and I'll also be honest with you, this is the first poetry book I've read seriously. So thanks to Mr. Sibal and also to the VIF that I had to do this. Now he's really given in the book voice and compressed long years of his service and varied experience into this book. And his ruminations have bared his heart out as a diplomat, as a father, as an observer, as a thinker. And most importantly, as a proud Indian, the last bit very important. And the fiercely proud Indian, there's no doubt about it. We've had lots of chats on these issues together. Now, his poetry comes with a philosophical tinge, which is very obvious, given his distinction also as the first grand doctor of philosophy. I didn't know it. I discovered it only a few months back. But so there are plenty of surprises of that kind. Well, there are many poems which one would like to recite to you, but there are two experts and poets here. But still, I can't help but say one or two sentences, but one or two important poems. And obviously, the subject is Pakistan, first of all. Yeah, unless you mention them at least once a day, you don't get proper sleep. So no policy can simply be keep talking to the enemy. The fear is there that the long rope we give to Pakistan in hope of its remorse, the form could well be used to hang an India all confused. Another one, which is, I do not know whether I should say it or not, but I'll say it. It's again about them. Accepting Pakistan is too a victim of terror like you is like agreeing a rapist must be seen as a victim of his lust. Now, I have given this book to, after I have scanned for it, that I have given this book to one of our research analysts to just get a random view on it. But to my surprise, she landed up with a poem in his honor. So that also, that is Anushri. I don't know if she's here. Yeah, Anushri. Good. What she's written is, what transcends the notion of wrong and right is like both sides of the coin. Your blood, your sight. And of course, it's a longish one, so I'll leave you with that. But this is the impact of your book, and it's really been a pleasure to read through it. Now, I must also introduce the two poets, scholars come poets here. Ambassador Sibal, everybody knows. He's been the foreign secretary, then he's been an ambassador to Russia after his superannuation, earlier ambassador to Egypt, and many jobs in the ministry. Now, he's also been international doctor of philosophy and then a full professor from the European Academy of Informatization and the World Informatization Information Distributed University. And also now presently he is a dean, well, he's been for a number of years, of the VIF in international relations. Mr. Daruwalla again. He is a former Indian police officer who retired as a additional secretary in research and analysis wing. And he's a living figure in poetry in India. And he's written many books, or 12 books. Then, of course, he's also been, the president of, rather is currently the president of the Poetry Society of India and is based in Delhi. So that's the program. We'll carry on till 6:45. And generally, the program would be now reading by the author, the launch of the book, and then the two poets in conversation with each other. And after that, any questions or anything if anybody may have. So on to Ambassador Sibal.
We can have to release first.
After we release?
Some poems because the conversation would give the context, but we can do the other way around. I can unveil all my secrets and then that'll give him an opportunity to talk to me about my book itself and any other questions that he may have in mind with regard to my interest in poetry and all such questions that are asked on occasions like this. We had agreed that we will not rehearse anything, we will just have an impromptu conversation. Now, I started writing poetry in college itself, so I might say that I've been writing for the last 55 years. But initially, like all young men who write poetry, because they get excited by all sorts of things, much of that, when I reread it, didn't seem quite contemporaneous, seemed passé, stilted, and not really reflecting what you felt, your real sentiments, but artificial. Because you read some poets, you get influenced, you try and imitate them. And then slowly, as time passes, you develop your own idiom, and your sentiments become more genuine, your feelings become more genuine, and then you are able to express in your own language and in your own words what you really feel about things. The other thing is that being old-fashioned, I believe in poetry which is in rhyme. I mean, free verse is fine. I have a lot of poems in free verse too. Free verse, of course, does not impose any straitjacket on you. As somebody has written, actually a free verse is just prose broken up into lines. So if you have, if you write well and if you have a sense of, if your imagery is attractive and you can put it in evocative phrases, you can always big it up and make it look like a poem. But if you have to write, if you have to write in rhyme, it imposes a lot of discipline on you. Because you have to, in technical terms, every line has to have certain number of syllables and feet, and of course there has to be a rhyming structure. Some people might say that prevents you from freely expressing yourself. But this debate will carry on, and to my mind, if poetry is in rhyme, it has a lot of music in it. And it's a combination of words and music, and that's what makes it attractive. The other thing I'd like to say is that the fact that I've been in the diplomatic service and have been involved in thinking about international relations and equations between powers and concepts of international relations and how nations interact with each other, and etc., etc. So there is a section of the book which deals with my experience of diplomacy, and I will release something about that also, about India's negotiating style. And being a true-blooded Indian diplomat, naturally Pakistan has to figure on your mental landscape. So there are quite a few points on how we have dealt with Pakistan. I also not spared some political personalities, current ones, because of their foibles and their positions on things, which easily lends itself to satire. There are a lot of satirical poems on some of our personalities, political personalities, but maybe I won't read that because there may be some amongst the audience who may have more sympathy toward them than I have. As I said, I've been writing for a long, long time. And it was a difficult decision to publish it, because at the end of the day, poetry is self-expression to the core. And exposing yourself, especially when it comes to sentiment and feelings and your view on life, etc., etc. But then I felt that poetry is also a form of, very powerful form of social communication. And so why not take the plunge and have the book published, which Bloomsbury has done. And there it is. And finally, I must say that my stay in Moscow, and I begin with that, somehow put me in a, what I might call a poetic mood. Maybe it's the Moscow winter, the snow falling outside, the cold temperature, the gloom, the grayness around, and especially after you have retired from the post of Foreign Secretary and you are going into an environment where your canvas gets shrunk, and then the nature outside does not lend itself to cheer and joy. So you become reflective, and you think about the past and everything else. And that's the book, Snowflakes of Time. Because as you grow older, you tend to, not always, but you tend to live in the past. Because at the end of the day, you know, every moment that you live becomes a memory. And everything in your past life is a memory, your experience itself is, your knowledge itself is, in the form of memory. And when you are in that kind of reflective mood at a certain age, when memories tend to play a larger life in your mental landscape, you get into that kind of mood, and I've expressed that mood in my poem. So I'll begin my first, I'll recite the first poem, which is Snowflakes of Time. Across the window of his mind, memories like snowflakes softly fell, with no pattern of any kind, floating and drifting by pell-mell. As he grasped them, he saw them melt, leaving behind moist sentiment, and in that muffled calm he felt pangs of nostalgic discontent. To denuded branches of time, the flitting flakes were clinging fast. He was an actor past his prime, a spectator of his own past. From skies within him undefined, fall moments gone in layers congealed, crystals like particles of mind through passing seasons lie concealed. When a reflective mood is on, how it happens he does not know, through open window of time gone, he sees the falling of the snow. Well, that was a rhymed verse. Now to show you that I can also write in free verse, another poem written in Moscow, which is Asleep in February. The ground huddled itself beneath a thick white quilt, pulling it over its limbs to shield itself from the piercing wind that swept across in gold buffets and hissed as though it blew through cracks and crevices in unseen frigid walls. The hand of chill had gripped the air and cracked it into crystals. And as the snow fell, the ground tucked its feet further in, curled up its legs and arms, covered its face and head, ready to slumber long. While outside, fanning out dark branches like dried estuaries, their rustling leaves long gone, swayed silently amidst the howling currents. And as night descended, glow worms of ice drifted through the slanting light of lampposts and settled on the quilt beneath the ground, lay fast asleep. Then I go into a different, well, it's related, the memory and nostalgia. And nostalgia you can only have for pleasant memories, obviously not for. But the phenomenon of nostalgic memories, that's what I have tried to portray in this poem. The torch of nostalgia. Nostalgia, like a torch, probed the still woods of the past. Memories lit up like shining eyes dispersed of creatures that blend with the night. Startled in their response, startled in their repose, they scurried. The crackle of dried leaves and solitary calls echoed in the dark chambers of the trees. An alert was sounded by the senses as feline temptations emerging from cover prowled with padded stealth, and flight of feathers sailed through the silent air soundlessly to prey upon the moments of the past. But with the coming light of the present, the torch was switched off, and nostalgia, like the night, faded into the day. There is another, because the book is divided into several sections. The first was Moscow Musings. The second was Memories. The third is Reflections. It's Bubbles That Burst. Hopes, like bubbles, surface from his mind, but pop in contact with reality, vanishing without a trace, glistening with iridescence of expectations. They rise, inflated by desire and stressed as far by longing as they can, they float momentarily. From the pipe of his life, dipping into the soft solution of his imagination, he can blow bubbles of hope at will. Beautiful as they are wafted up by the current of his yearnings, briefly, till they burst, always. Okay, I'll skip some because then it'll become too long, because there are several sections. But here's one which is in the section called Catharsis. it's something that you feel, a musician should feel when he's playing music. And how you can relate to the sentiments and the feelings that permeate his him when he plays the music, and how they have an impact on you. Stringed music. He plucked the string and a note escaped, full of feeling, a sigh of pleasure, a moan of satisfaction that caused the chords of longing within him to resonate. As his fingers moved with dexterity over the length of the taut strings back and forth, as if to excite the last syllable of desire buried in the tension in them, he felt his own emotions swell into waves of inspiration that risked constantly to spill over, but yet remained within the discipline of the scale, the cycle, and the rhythm, bursting against the seams of control like floodwaters rising and pressing against the embankment walls, threatening to breach them but always at the end, lapping the edges and subsiding, and then pursuing the flow in different waves, weaves and battens, halls and eddies, and foaming crests, the sentence of motion always repeating itself. That high pitch reached, neither the instrument nor the musician could sustain it without end. The strings lose their tension, the emotions that gnaw at them with grasping fingers begin to drain away after the crescendo, when the instrument becomes the world, and when his reach extends to the farthest corners of the universe. There is silence of depletion and exhaustion, of contentment, the flattened sine wave that becomes the baseline for another burst of turbulence, an uncoiling of rewound desire later. Now this poem, I leave you how to interpret it. Since many of my colleagues, very illustrious ones in the room, have now retired from active service, so if they see some allegory in this, you may be right, you may be wrong, but I'll leave it to you. The lamppost. The lamppost stands, when first erected, shining fresh with gleaming glass, confident in its functions, it felt excited to begin its journey of service, happy to be exposed to the cavalcade of life, cars, buses, scooters, rickshaws, and pedestrians passing by in varying rhythm and numbers throughout the daylight hours, the shouting, the beeping, the honking, the bells, the dance of the feet, the fumes, the smells, disturbing it not. At night, under the dark sky, its bright radiance spread its circle on the ground, lighting the silence and catching the feline glow of passing eyes. When the sun beat down, it did not perspire. When the rain came, it felt washed. The crack of lightning and the thunder did not make it cover, nor did it run for cover when the storm came and the wind blew in buffets. It stood steadfast. And so the lamppost stood year after year in changing weather and seasons, in the heat, the cold, in the dust and lashes of rain, the paint began to fade and peel off. Its face lost its glow and blotches appeared, the grit went into its pores, its glass coated with grime, and bulbs not always replaced, it lost its swagger and the air of optimism accompanying the exuberance of its earlier years. It looked dispirited and forlorn and dejected, with its dim light now seeking to break through cracked strips of translucent glass, its radiance now reaching only half-heartedly on the pulsating life below, of which it no longer felt it was a wanted part. As the dog eased itself against it, and blasted posters torn by the wind fluttered along its girth like memories of events now forgotten. Its clogged car's ears did not miss the remarks that floated up with the particles of pollution that life churned up in its frenzy. The lamppost has done its ears, it's too old. They should now bring it down and replace the eyesore. So now we come to the fun part. This section of the book is called Humor. And here, again, since we have stalwarts of the Indian Diplomatic Service here, let me give you my view of negotiation Indian style. Negotiation really means that you count very well your beans and bring them with skill into play so that at the end of the day, in your pocket, you have more than the number with which you began. It is the art of how to steal advantage and yet make others feel that none has failed to pass the test of doing for themselves the best and validate again the spin is one more case of a win-win. But this last concept is a fake. With dose of salt, one should intake. In every game, you win or lose, a draw the people now refuse. And so they wait with bated breath for winners of the sudden death. The rules of negotiations between what are called equal nations do not for tiebreakers provide to determine the winning side. So each can claim that it has won, to settle which there is no one. The point is that in such parlays, the power of the stronger weighs more in the balance at the end, no matter what the weak pretend. The mental toughness not to yield is vital when you're in the field. Proneness to shift the bottom line is a debilitating sign, as is craving for some success that makes you settle for much less, or tendency to be content with less than what was your intent, and see in anything you get a little gain from a big bet. As in bridge hand, when you can claim a slam, you bid only for gain. It's dangerous a state of mind in negotiations of the kind that diplomats are called to do to push the nation's point of view. You may ask why all this ink I have thus spent on what I think are elements of key import in this hard diplomatic sport, and where in our great nation's case in toughness table we find place. The problem is that we are taught there is no single view or thought that cannot with another live, so as we take, so must we give. The ghosts of renunciation, haunting our negotiation, stand in the way of being tough. The point at which we say enough is far too quickly reached by us. We don't like making too much fuss about things which in our confusion we see merely as illusion. The others know that at the end, under their pressure, we will bend. This was in the context of the nuclear deal, you know, and Musharraf. Our handling of the nuclear deal does our temperament really. We bought into Musharraf's game of lifting from him any blame for terrorism. In our view, he's equal victim of it too. It's our great diplomatic feat to see some success in defeat. Well, again, kneeling for diplomatic slaughter. Obviously, again, this Pakistan, my better recession. It's most difficult to find the sense of what is in our mind. Of course, Modi has changed this with surgical strikes. Why is it we so obdurate in wanting to ingratiate ourselves to Pakistan despite peace prospects being nowhere in sight? The strategy we have deployed is like an echo from the void. If you are a boxer in the ring, you've got to know one basic thing, that if in course of every round you let your adversary pound your body with persistent blows until from all the cuts blood flows, and your plan is not to hit back, but shield yourself from each attack, with forearms raised covering your face while standing passively in place, you can be sure that such a feat will always end up in defeat. This just is not the way to deal with the neighbor's murderous dealing. Why should we act like a meek goat, bowed to be killed with a slit throat by virulent jihadi groups serving as terrorists, paratroops like Jaish and LET and such Islamist groups running amok, nurtured as instruments of state to grease the politics of hate that Mumbai symbolized the last with Kabul, a bloody bypass. All that we do is to repeat with a demeaning plaintive plea that policies of using terror end up as a costly error, that dialogue alone's the course, that problems can't be solved by force. And we believe it's vital to live as good neighbor Lead us, good neighbor, with you. With platitudes of peace we make, too little of the blows we take. Asking our neighbor not to strike with terror, to us is quite like telling a gunman he should shoot, a raider that he should not loot, a predator that it mustn't prowl, or a jackal it should not howl. Accepting Pakistan is too a victim of terror like you, is like agreeing a rapist must be seen as victim of his lust. And when its leaders glibly quip that when they make once more a trip to Delhi, they must get a sign we are ready to fall in line with their demand that Kashmir be the subject of priority, our answer should be then to say at home you are most welcome to stay. But we are on dialogue so bent we go to the absurd extent of moaning that we can't permit the luxury of stopping it. From our leaders, we expect a policy of self-respect, sparing people and the nation feelings of humiliation, but by helplessness that we display, our morale sags day after day. No policy can simply be keep talking to the enemy. The fear is real that the long rope we give to Pakistan in hope of its reform would well be used to hang in India all confused. Okay. There are many more on our nuclear deal, counting 1, 2, 3 of the nuclear deal. It's amusing, well, if you have a chance to read it. But there's one on the visit of Rina Havani Khar. let me say, but I don't want to. It's amusing, so if you are interested, you can continue. Okay, it's called The Birkin Bag. From pages of a fashion mag, she stepped out with a Birkin bag. Now, remember S.M. Krishna was the organist, then you'll make sense of this. She stepped out with a Birkin bag. The brand bitten gave her high grades for sporting Kavali sunshades. Her ankles strapped in GB2 got noticed with approval too. The reporting did not quite fit a high political visit, as interest was most intense in her display of fashion sense. With Pakistan, there should be more to focus than on what she wore. From time it got independence, Pakistan has put up one big pretense. It now had a plan of action of creating a distraction by having an attractive face present the country's sordid case. Her masters thought, who better could show they were changing for the good? With their duplicity laid bare after the Bin Laden affair, the young and modern woman might, the reason give them means to fight the image of a failing state racked by extremism and hate. Convey it would be an error to blame Pakistan. To blame Pak for all global terror. She could be effectively used against the Indians all confused, who do not know what grip to hold. Now they blow hot and then blow cold, stating at times the Paks must act on terror first and then retract to pronounce that it is their view that dialogue must continue. So Pakis thought they'll cook our goose in PR games by letting loose that Birkin bag. Our press lapped up the last dregs from a fashion cup. It was for us so damaging, we lost content to packaging. The visit losing its import became an accessories report. Her masters also thought to gain from sharpening our sense of pain from such a visible contrast between the present and the past. A new collection on display with reduced stock from yesterday. A well-set wig and flowing hair, a stuffy room and open air, a ruminant and eagle doe, a challenger and faded troll, one bucked up and articulate, other well past its sell-by date. An almost 80 who is more than twice her age of 34, the Pakistanis showed us how they play the politics of how. The Birkin bag then would contain tools for one key end to attain. Pakistan had to look better than it is, rest did not matter. A lot of gloss needed to hide, ways Pak take all for a ride, a good supply of touch and glow, so their real skin tone will not show. A range of creams for night and day to keep telltale wrinkles at bay, and masks to make the face look bright, so as to lessen the great fright the world now feels about the fate of Pakistan as crumbling state. So that's the reason, as it were, for which Hina Rabbani Khar, to give her country false Elan, is now FM of Pakistan. Okay. Now I have to choose between two of Musharraf's enlightened moderation or the bet. Okay, I'll just choose one of who is betting too long. Okay, let me do the bet. You guess what the bet is, who the bet is. For years, he has no peace of mind while dealing with the canon kind. Too early when it was a pup, his home training was given up. The corner where to urinate, the drill for this was left too late. With nose not rubbed in the dirt, it did not get lessons that hurt. His barking was never controlled, and so it has grown old. Its habit, and so as it has grown old, his habit cannot be set right of barking all through day and night. This is now difficult to cure because it feels so insecure. As soon as there is silence around, it needs the barks, assuring sound. As it over the years has grown of shadow scared, even its own. By constant barking, it creates impression that it anticipates a danger from some source without to its sacred canine redoubt. One thinks one can ensure this way that scrutiny is kept away of failings that are internal by cacophony external. What's worse, if it happens to see somewhere in its periphery a neighbor merely walking by, intent to let sleeping dogs lie, with no gesture that could provoke and any move that could evoke a feeling that he might mean ill, each time a barking seizure will begin, which then will continue long after he is out of view. Some others have begun to mark this great propensity to bark and thought of putting it to use as local watchdog on the loose. They gave it a nice collar, new and many juicy bones to chew. Then let their bounty unleash with shiny chains and a long leash. Thus pampered, it felt it had right to big bark and a bigger bite. With all the loud incessant din of those around were in a very edgy frame of mind and altogether felt inclined to tell the neighbor it must do to calm the canine something too. They said they were feeling perturbed that peace around was being disturbed so that they can serenely live. They asked what the neighbor could give. The neighbor said, for this canine, the responsibility is not mine. This something one should not forget, it certainly is not my pet. Each time I pass, it lunges at my shin, it wants a part of that. With its bare fangs, it snarls at me when I am in the vicinity, what obligation I have to sacrifice my own leg for you. I cannot change my home, I must live where I do. It's not just that merely to gain attention, it's bent on creating tension. Why should my passive innocent that canine breed should so resent? To deal with this daily offense, if I were to, in self-defense, use a big stick to beat the dog each time it barks, give it a flog, instill in it so great a fear that its barking should disappear. If these means I resolve to use, I know, or will at once accuse me of curbing the canine's right to use its fangs for a big bite. Some others will solemnly state responsible and proportionate. The SPCA will then report how lacking in legal support was action that I undertook in front of all to make me look a monstrous kind, whose insolence makes all the harmless canines tense. Those who support the canine breed, the monstrous kind, whose insolence makes all the harmless canines tense. Those who support the canine breed will think what more it would need to build for it a better defense by way of a protective fence under which it could still lunge at passing shins, take routine plunge and continue in his own way of barking loudly night and day. The victim, truly perplexed, is he can't do that, he can't do this, he can't be stick, he has in hand, yes, hostile feelings will be fanned. The canine will thus breed turmoil and keep the tensions on the boil. To the canine, he cannot say, if you want more terrain to play, more space in which to urinate, I'll give you a part of my estate. The canine continues to bite, unceasingly barks day and night. Through yells and yelps it ever tries, the neighborhood to terrorize. Okay, the last one is playful. You know, they're called shape points, where write a point, but you give it a shape. It's not easy because you have to spend a lot of time to make sure that every syllable is, every word, every syllable, every comma, every grammatical sign is so controlled that the shape is maintained. So this poem is our work of Sante, and it's on champagne. If one could think of life simply as a glass of pink champagne, within whose smooth, clear crystal confines reflecting the light, moments bubble up with a lucent and constant effervescence, like a steady stream of excitement that flows on transparently, carrying in its wake blended, subtle flavors of soft pungency, titillating the senses and lacing them with pleasant headiness, fermenting emotions that express themselves in tiny bursts of delight, exuding unique aromas of a rare piquant satisfaction. But then how much champagne could one really imbibe without the palate of time becoming coated with surfeit and years apathetic as appetite cloyed with excess, months like taste buds shriveled with indulgence, days emptied of desire with overstimulation, the hangover of happiness and depression is the same, and with too much water, pleasures like soil become saline, champagne too loses its fizz, and its voluptuousness becomes stale, like old stories told and retold with no suspense left, only an empty repetition of words. Life should be like change of seasons, colorful spring followed by heat and glowing summer, the advance of autumn then casting a red and golden shadow replaced by pristine white mantles of a frosty and benumbing winter, when instead of chirping birds, only the black crows hop on the branches until the redolent spring, like bubbly pink champagne, is ready to chill again. And it's in the shape of a champagne cup.
Very happy to be here in front of a very distinguished audience, including my erstwhile High Commissioner, Mr. Rasgotra, and so many friends of mine, and of course, Vivekananda Sibal, with whom I was in college. I was also with his other brother, Jitendra Sibal.
Where is he?
So I can claim to know the family well, though I see Kanwal more on the TV screen than on the than in person, if I may say so. Congratulations, firstly, for the book, Kanwal, and for the reading. But poetry must have been brewing within you for quite a while before you wrote it. Now, are these the poems of, say, a decade, or have they been written in the last 4 or 5 years? You know, post-retirement, some people go to the ashram, some people write poetry, some people take to other hobbies. I'm sure this is not a hobby, there's a passion with you. Poetry is always a passion. So I'd like to ask you what your journey of writing has been over the last, say, 10 years.
Well, actually, I began writing in college, as I said, and I may say that I've been writing for, sounds like a ominously long time, 55 years. But the earlier poems, which I have many, 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 but except a few, I wrote one which is in the book on Bhutto's nightmare, 1965, when the war took place. I have written a poem on that, which also, I should say, underlines the fact that my concerns about Pakistan, or my views on Pakistan, became pretty well defined even before I joined the diplomatic service, because this was written in 1965 and I joined in 1966. There are subsequently other poems too, which date back to the
previous years, 40, 50 years ago, several of them. Initially, when I began writing, since I did MA in English literature, so I came into close contact with English poetry. And you know what the syllabus is. The Shakespeare's funnies attracted me a lot. And I wrote a lot of them. But naturally, at this age, you can't go around publishing your sonnets, which you wrote 50 years ago, whatever. But what I've done in this book is I have destructured. I have presented the sonnets in such a way they just don't look like sonnets. And the themes are not love at all. The themes are descriptive they relate to sentiments, part of an abstract kind. So I've done that also. And these poems also date to that period. But the Moscow poems were obviously written in Moscow. I was ambassador there from 2004 to 2007.
To talk of craft, do you sometimes write in, say, blank verse or free verse, and then turn it into rhyme? Do you ever do that?
No.
The rhymes come on their own.
In fact, I find the writing free verse very easy, frankly. Very, very easy. Because all you need is a mastery of words and mastery of images. And you can always sound profound. Very easy. But when you have to write in rhyme, it requires a lot of discipline. Because first of all, you have to make it sound that it is not versification. That you are simply rhyming words, because that's the only way you can find to rhyme with something else you've written before. It has to make sense, it has to be coherent, it has to express an integrity of feeling, it has to be properly structured, etc., etc. So that takes time, but I like writing rhyme because it takes much longer to write that poem.
I agree with that. But sometimes rhyme has the habit of leading you by the nose as far as the next line is concerned, the sense. You know, rhyme becomes somehow more important than the content. I myself do a lot of rhyming, so I have great respect for people who rhyme. America, nobody rhymes. England, they are first rate at it. I mean, if you ask even college boys or school girls to write a sonnet, they will manage one, you know, perfectly. So I have great respect for rhyme. And I'm glad that you have taken to it right from the start, though there are some poems which are in verse libre, and I'm very happy to see them. I also noticed that you have gone into, let's say, the landscape of Russia. The first few poems are on winter and on snow. But obviously, you must have seen much beyond the snow and beyond within the mantle of snow, what happens in Russia. And Russia has a tremendous history of being rather harsh towards its poets, whether it was Pasternak or Mandelstam or Anna Akhmatova, as you must have seen. Did you ever think of writing about the kind of regime they had during the Stalinist winter, if I may ask?
No, two things. One, of course, is that...
What did your position as an ambassador stand in the way of that?
No, since I was not publishing my poems, I could write anything I wanted in private. But frankly, I never thought of writing political poems on repression in Russia and the fate of poets and the maltreatment by the Communist Party. That subject didn't inspire me, but it was more my relation to the landscape. The snow-capped landscape and the feelings it invoked. Because the trees become bare, and there are... There's a poem here where I describe the winter trees.
Winter trees, yes.
The winter, the trees in winter, what yes. They look.
begin to see branches, dark branches, like estuaries, crooked fingers, you know, spread all over across your window, is quite dramatic. Or simply the falling of the snow, or making a sense of what it really means, relating to the aspect of nature involved rather than politics. No, I never thought of that. When it comes to politics, I stick to Pakistan.
So you divided your sentiments and your life into two compartments, politics on one end and poetry on the other.
No, I've written about double standards. In fact, your little blurb on this relates to that poem on double standards. I've also written about what some other non-Soviet, non-Russian countries are doing on the international landscape. But in the political context of treatment of smaller weak nations and intervention and double standards and things like that, I've written about that. I've written about multipolarity also in a humorous way, of course.
Landscapes can also be very evocative. I mean, poetry on landscapes. For example, your poem on the lamppost, I found very evocative. In fact, I was reminded of the London evening, settling down with smell of steaks in passageways, 6 o'clock, the burnt out ends of smoky days, and then a gusty shower wraps the ground, the scraps of withered leaves about your feet, etc. So, the main thing about a landscape poem is that something should come out of it, and it should not be a camera shot. And you have achieved that in poem after poem, and I would like to congratulate you on that, because the trouble with Indian poets, I must say, is they don't take to the landscape. You take all the, after Nisim Ezekiel and possibly Dom, there's nobody who talks about the landscape, and there's a lot of confessional poetry and going within you, something I avoid. If there is nothing within you, I don't know how can I write about it.
No, in fact, there's a big section in my book which is Nature's Born.
Yes.
This is all related.
I know.
To your internal mood and the and nature, and where I have had inspiration from is the merging of the outer and inner realities. I found that happening very often, where my inner mood is reflected in what is outside, and what is outside gets reflected in inner mood. And in the poems, in some of the poems, you will see the passage from what is internal to what is external, and you really can't figure out clearly whether this poem relates to what is happening outside or what is happening inside, because the two are amalgamated. Quite graphically, quite descriptively in some of the poems, I think, at least.
What about influences? I'm a little wary of asking this question. I asked a bureaucrat, I was interviewing him on Doordarshan, half an hour, imagine. And I started by asking him, what have you read and what are your influences? And he said, I don't read poetry, I only write it. So that is I would not expect an answer like that from you.
I was thinking of giving the same answer.
Who were your influences apart from just the English poets, which we all read, you know, the 19th century poets we all read in college. But did European poetry, because that is a very big segment of poetry,
now, I tell you what,
come into your ken earlier?
I must confess that, all of us who did English literature in those years, our relation to poetry ended with Wordsworth and Shelley and Keats and people like that.
The
Romantic poets, and it finished with T.S. Eliot, and after that, nothing really. Now, of course, the syllabus must have changed, and modern poetry must be included in the syllabus, I'm sure. But I have tried very consciously to find my own idiom. Now, it's very difficult to say whether any poet has influenced me or not influenced me, because if there has been any influence, it is subliminal. Subliminal, it is in the subconsciousness. I have not really tried to emulate in any way the writing of any poet. Now, some people tell me that some of the poems are satirical ones. There are a few. Remind them of Jonathan Swift or Alexander Pope or this or that. I did read them, but I read them 50 years ago. And whether some seeds of that still remain in somewhere in my mental landscape, it may be possible, but certainly not when I write. I try to find my own idiom entirely and do not want to be imitative in any way, because to my mind that is actually, I would feel self-demeaned if I said to myself that I'm trying to measure up to anybody else. I do what I write what I want to write in my own idiom, and that's it.
Would you consider a translation, say, of Kaligula or something? Have you ever gone into the field of translations at all, or never?
No. Well, actually...
Oh, Fez is no, easier to translate.
I tell you, you mentioned earlier my brother, he was telling me that he led a mutual admiration society in
yes.
college, because he writes poetry. You write poetry, of course. My father was extremely formal to poetry,
yes.
very knowledgeable. His passion was to recite Kali to himself. When I went on walks with him, 4, 5, 6 kilometers, he would hum Kali's ghazals and try to interest me. I must say that when I was younger in college, when he was doing that, I felt a bit, I didn't relate to it, because I thought the imagery was stereotyped, was sterile, same wretched power up going around the candle and stuff like that. Since I was reading English poetry and much more modern poetry and much more varied imagery, I felt that Urdu poetry was stuck in a time warp. Later on, when I became less intolerant and wiser, I found that I missed a lot, and I wish I had related to that and imbibed a lot of his interest in Urdu poetry, and then gone in the direction that you were saying. Because now, when I recall some of the things he used to narrate to me, I find him absolutely wonderful. And my brother writes poetry in Urdu also, and my two elder brothers, they good knowledge of Urdu, because they were still in school when partition took place. My brother-in-law knows Urdu very well, but I am ignorant of Urdu, unfortunately.
The trouble about Urdu poetry is poets are writing to poets, literally. It is becoming fairly inaccessible, and that's why the readership is going down. I was with a French poet in Paris. I went with Mashweta Devi, and it was a long evening. Between the two of us, we drank, I remember, 3 bottles of wine. I think Mashweta must have taken one wine glass, but the two of us went at it. And I asked him, why can't I find an English translation of your poetry? So he said, first the French poets became so surreal that they lost their readership, then they lost their publishers, and lastly they lost their translators. So, and the next day Claude Simon won the Nobel Prize, and a man from the embassy who accompanied us told us that this is a scandal, because he is exactly the person whom the other French poet was referring to. So I am very happy that the poetry, at least what you have written, is accessible to the reader. And I think that is of primary importance.
I think you've touched a very, very important point. And I said that in the preface to my book, that part of the reason why I'm unable to relate to much of modern poetry is, of course, it is highly self-indulgent. Actually, poetry is self-indulgence. It can be at tolerable levels and it can be at intolerable levels. Now, what happens in much of modern poetry is that it becomes very abstruse. It becomes like a crossword puzzle. And you don't know what exactly the poet wants to say. And the imagery and the references are very obscure. Sometimes there is a desire to show your knowledge and your erudition and your scholarliness by alluding to something which then the reader firstly doesn't understand, and then he has probably Google it or go to the dictionary and find out what it means. It's off-putting. I mean, to my mind, poems should not make the reader feel he has no sensibility. I mean, the moment you start reading a poem and it's been a published poem and it carries a big name, and you say, look, it doesn't make any sense to me, you feel small, because you say to yourself, obviously it doesn't make sense because the guy is well known and he sells well and he's got a reputation. That should not be the purpose of poetry. And I think poetry should appeal to you immediately. You may not like it, but you should be able to comprehend it and find some empathy with what is being written. To my mind, that is extremely, extremely important.
What about music? You have a very fine poem called The Raga. You remember. What is your relationship with Indian classical music, etc.? I mean,
well, I don't want to be pretentious to say that I'm very knowledgeable about Indian classical music, but I love it. I love it and I hear it.
Would you mind if I read it out to you?
Yes, please.
The Raga. He built it up slowly despite the pressure of unvocalized notes that coursed inside him like a river of unheard sound. He was not impatient to express himself. Like undulating waves and eddies of emotion, unseen but felt, the notes released images without form into the air again and again. Poised like a hummingbird or lingering like a bee, he severed the pollen of beauty, moving on in a meandering course to compositions of fragrance on its path. Each time he realized the predictable, embellished by the unpredictable, a beautiful line there, the expected and the unexpected, coalescing into a harmonious whole of experience. With the creative urge in abundant flow, unnoticed the tempo increased, the yearning of the soul expressed at the start in a drawn-out, languorous syllables had imperceptibly become a pressing and incessant rhythm, a yearning of the flesh at the heartbeat faster, as the heartbeat faster and hunger demanded more. The circles grew tighter, concentrics, you know, the circles grew tighter, the waves more turbulent, until in a crescendo, with notes swirling and collapsing over each other, the urging of the chords in that stretch of time had exhausted itself with a long, trailing note. His self had subsided into a calm and satisfaction that follows the stirrings of creation. It was a raga of ardor. Congratulations.
What I was talking about, where what is outside and inside becomes the same. I put myself.
But was this after a performance?
No, not necessarily. Not immediately after a performance. But yes, that what the sentiments and emotions and yearnings and the desire to achieve a certain artistic height that the instrumentalists were aspiring to resonated inside me. And that's where the external and the internal reality get merged. That was the sense.
Congrats. All the very best. Thank you.
Would anyone like to ask him something?
Certainly.
Yeah, okay, certainly.
Any mic here?
Hi.
Kamal, congratulations on several accounts. Number one, how could you hide this from your family? No, not family, friends of 55 years. Tremendous. Now, to use the expression, the print had not yet dried. When is your next sequel coming?
Well, I won't live another 55 years.
Let us book another date next year, because I'm sure your creative mind is already working on Donald Trump and Putin. The two countries you have served long and know very well.
No, Donald Trump, yes, I could write something.
You have, if you can do it in next 70 days before his inauguration, I can assure you in English you will be syndicated the world over. Now tell me one thing more. It's a serious question and not in a jest. You are a columnist. You have been writing so much in the newspapers. Why haven't you used this medium to comment? Because what your poetry is, not just a pigment of imagination, not related to reality, it is very much down to earth on the ground. Would you be considering the next column you write, one or two columns, which could be in poem?
Well, it could be done, but then, you know, I don't think newspapers have gone into that kind of publication of poems instead of columns to deal with current political events. I think there'll be a huge departure. Yes, maybe in some magazine you could contribute such stuff, but I don't think it can become a regular feature. And then, you know, also I tell you what, if you start doing that, somebody may then say that, look, this guy is trying to overproject himself. He wants to tell the world that he writes poetry. So he started writing columns in poetry. I must tell you something interesting, though. In one of my postings, when the ministry first introduced self-assessment column in our confidential reports. And again, when I say belonging to the old school, at that time I didn't belong to the old school, I was young. But I felt that this was absurd. I mean, how can you say something about yourself? You can't say anything negative about yourself. But how can you write yourself, which is a great chap, you've done all this and you've changed these relationships between you and that country and stuff like that. So I did write a poem as part of my CR. Twice I did that, it's still in the ministry's records. I did that, but that was not meant for public consumption.
How was it received by the...
Nobody reacted, and I became foreign secretary, so it's okay.
Not a poet by any means, but you actually provoked me to write a few lines on Pakistan, of course. An eye for an eye makes everyone blind. If Kashmir did not provide a crutch, would we be stuck in straits as such? Would we be able to relate to our kind instead of forever remain in a bind? Thank you.
It's been a fascinating evening. Normally, those who write poetry and those who read poetry are said to be a little touched in the head. Each one of the poems you read out has been a gem. My compliments and congratulations. I have a request to both the poets on the panel. It is said that all good poetry is sad poetry. Your comments, please.
Sad. Now, you know, you asked a very pertinent question. If you are, now I don't want this to be misunderstood, I'm a very happy man. But if you are so happy, you are having a wonderful life, you are dining out, drinking wine, playing tennis, traveling all over the world, spending your time amusing yourself, you can't write poetry. It'll deaden your sensibilities altogether. However, if something troubles you, positively and negatively, you fall in love, you fall out of love, somebody dear to you leaves you, or some death occurs, or anything of that kind, any shock or this or that, that can give you the incentive to express yourself. I think to that extent, happiness kills poetry. Or you can write things that appear in Christmas cards and this and that sort of stuff. But serious poetry means that there is, has to be some urge somewhere to express yourself, which may be born some strength of feeling about certain things in a profound philosophical sense, or you know, I have in this book a section which is Nature's Bond, where I've written a lot of poems where I relate to nature, the beauty of the nature, and the sort of sentiment it evokes in you. That's also a form of happiness, but of a different kind. Yes, I would say that like all great writers need to be moved by some sort of a passion, whether it's the form of poetry or in prose. They ask you this question, sir. They ask you this question.
What is your message regarding relationship between alcohol and poetry?
Well, that I should, we should ask Ghalib and people like that. The Urdu poets, I mean, this is one of the things that used to annoy me. Saki, saki, saki. So, I mean, we must move out of that imagery. But then that was the idiom of that time. And the reference to Saki referred to certain kinds of relationships, social equations, the social system as such. But I think that is a bit of a posture. I don't drink alcohol much. And I think alcohol deadens your senses. I'm not too sure whether you need the stimulant of alcohol to stimulate your creative urges, though in some cases, depending on the personality of an individual, it may quite be true that a little bit of alcohol might release certain internal energies which push them to write. But essentially, this is a posture, it's a fiction written, that you need to be a drunkard to write good poetry.
I just heard you say that serious poetry is about sadness and melancholy and things like that. What strikes me that if poetry is an expression of life, there are so many things in life, including happiness and joy. And we are familiar with poets who have written very beautifully about joy and things like that. So, fine, I'm not saying that serious poetry is not at a level which needs respect, but every level, as long as the emotion is genuine, can we say that any poetry is inferior to the other? Milton, he wrote a long time ago that come and trip it as you go on the light, fantastic tone. That's beautiful. So I think if we take a more comprehensive view of poetry, then all aspects of life, as long as the feeling behind things is genuine, it's genuine poetry.
No, true. I mean, it's not as if only those who are unhappy are to write poetry, and those who are unhappy have to deprive themselves of this creative urge. No, it's not that. I'm just saying that if you're too happy, it's a bit of a problem in writing poetry.
Oh, sorry, there's one more question.
My name is Ambassador Deepak Vora. Ambassador Sibal, on behalf of millions of your friends and admirers, thank you.
Thank you very much.
The publisher.
Oh, yes.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I hope somebody would ask Mr. Sibal what his favorite poem was. I actually forgot to ask him while working on this. Do you have one, sir?
The first one I did.
The first one. Thank you. I'm honored and privileged to have this opportunity to propose a vote of thanks on this special occasion. On behalf of Bloomsbury India, and on my, I would like to convey my deep regards and thanks to General Page, Director of the Vivekananda International Foundation, for agreeing to host this evening. I'd also like to thank Mr. Keki, Daruwalla for gracing this occasion, and all the ladies and gents here who make the time to join us for the launch of this wonderful collection of poems by Mr. Sibal. Thank you.
And ladies and gentlemen, I think we've had a refreshingly different and enjoyable evening. And thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks a lot, Mr. Daruwalla, for making it
more interesting and giving a lot of substance to it. So, a word of thanks for Mr. Sibal and Mr. Daruwalla. And may I have now the pleasure of presenting a moment?
Not done it for all this time.